25 years ago, Time magazine named the endangered Earth as its individual of the year. Its cover was adorned by the work of the famous sculptor Christo, as he produced an image of a suffering globe bound in plastic and twine. This award was due to the culmination of a series of events, most of which occurred during the 20th century. And by the year 1989, these events had reached such an extent that it prompted the magazine to make its decision. Welcome again. Today we consider the history of the modern environmental movement, tracing a series of events from the early 20th century through to the present day. At the turn of the 20th century, the population of the Earth stood at just over 1 billion. And by the mid-1950s, advances in medicine led to a great reduction in death rates, and despite two world wars, the planet's population tripled. 150 years earlier, the Englishman Thomas Malthus had predicted such growth, but his gloomy picture of a famine-stricken Earth was only avoided through the work of Norman Borloff, the father of what became known as the Green Revolution in agriculture. But the early 20th century brought much more than world wars and population increase. Advances in technology began to transform the lifestyle of millions of people. The automobile and the widespread use of electricity meant that fuels were needed in large amounts. And this spawned a cascade of inventions and innovations. Air conditioners and refrigerators became more widespread, and they were much safer to use, thanks to the discovery of CFCs as coolants. Other inventions like DDT were celebrated, as it brought widespread relief from the scourge of malaria. But all that glitters is not gold, and the 1950s would see the first of a string of environmental catastrophes as the waste from a rapidly developing society began to impact its food sources. In Minamata, Japan, methyl mercury accumulated in fish, leading to the notorious tragedy of Minamata. And it was also at this time that this woman, Rachel Carson, began to make a series of observations about the environmental impacts of DDT. Her 1962 publication entitled Silent Spring was widely recognized as one of the great literary works of the 20th century. President Kennedy set up a special task force to investigate the claims made by Carson, and by the time it was complete, a global environmental movement was beginning to take root. And it all led up to the first global environmental summit, the Earth Summit 1, the United Nations Convention on the Human Environment in Stockholm, Sweden, in 1972. Now it was not just DDT, but big American cities like Los Angeles and New York were beginning to experience the effects of automobile emissions and photochemical smog. Rising oil prices led to the energy crisis of the 1970s, and nuclear power was being considered as a viable source of energy. The gap between the rich and the poor countries continued to widen, and population growth in less economically developed countries continued unabated. Then, towards the end of the decade, the world received a huge wake-up call, first at Three Mile Island in Pennsylvania, with the nuclear plant meltdown, and then the housewife Lois Gibbs brought the tragedy of Love Canal, Niagara Falls, to global attention. It was through the work of Gibbs that the Superfund law was set up in the United States to clean up toxic waste sites. As we entered the 1980s, there was talk about human-induced climate change, global warming, and sea level rise. But while this was treated with skepticism in many quarters, the world watched in horror as a group of British researchers discovered a gaping hole in the planet's ultraviolet shield, the ozone layer. Such was the urgency of this issue that a 1983 convention on substances that deplete the ozone layer was called by the United Nations in Vienna, Austria. The need for action was urgent. While millions were affected by the Bhopal catastrophe in India, and millions more were affected by the tragic meltdown at the Chernobyl nuclear plant in the former Soviet Union, now Ukraine. Then in 1987, the world came to Montreal for a follow-up to the Vienna Convention. Good news, at last, for a suffering planet. Thanks to the low-cost technological solutions and the willingness of developed countries to take the lead, this agreement was destined to be a success. Years later, former UN Secretary General Kofi Annan described the Montreal Protocol as perhaps the single most successful international agreement to date. The term sustainable development was used by the former Norwegian President Gro Harlem Brundtland in her report to the World Commission on Environment and Development. Environmental groups like Greenpeace began to increase their impact as the world became increasingly aware of the need to balance development with environmental protection. And then came Time Magazine's Individual of the Year. The population growth continued, and television was reaching millions in developing countries. On March 24, 1989, the planet awoke to the horror of the Exxon Valdez oil spill as the graphic images of birds unable to fly due to oil-drenched feathers were sent to all parts of the planet through television and satellite technology. Soon, the world would meet in Rio de Janeiro in 1992 for the Earth Summit 2, the United Nations Convention on the Environment and Development. Here, Agenda 21 was opened. The Framework Convention on Climate Change was opened. The Biodiversity Convention was entered into. And throughout the 1990s, the global warming debate began to gather impetus. But the lack of definitive scientific evidence and the high cost associated with the phase-out of fossil fuels meant that the climate change agreements were destined for difficulty. Today, the climate change debate continues, but perhaps technology will get its house in order in the 21st century, and we will see solutions to many of the problems of the 20th century, so that all can enjoy the comforts of modern technology without compromising the quality of life. To analyze these events, we follow the lead of environmental sociologists Riley Catton and William Dunlap. Catton and Dunlap identified three human uses of the environment: the living space function, the supply depot function, and the waste repository function. And they pointed out that many of the conflicts of the latter part of the 20th century could be understood in the context of living space, supply depot conflict, waste repository, living space conflict, or supply depot, waste repository conflict. Taking this a step further, we can construct a Venn diagram where the rectangle represents the carrying capacity of the planet Earth, with each circle representing the pressures that humans place on the environment for the three functions. In time, as populations grow and technology advances, the size of each circle increases. Eventually, they begin to overlap. And this is where conflict occurs, where a living space function could become impacted by a waste repository function, or a supply depot function could be impacted by a waste repository function. Stop at this point and reflect on the cases presented in this lesson. See if you can find at least one example of a living space waste repository conflict and one example of a supply depot waste repository conflict. As human populations grow and develop and use resources, these circles will continue to expand. And if the carrying capacity of our environment stays the same, then ultimately we will begin to exceed the carrying capacity and enter into planetary overshoot with an ecological footprint that exceeds the carrying capacity of the Earth. Consider the example of the Three Gorges Dam. Here in this picture is the Dachan Township, which was submerged as a result of the rising water levels of the Yangtze River due to the construction of the mega dam. How would you classify this conflict in accordance with this diagram? Now it's your turn to head out into your own environment and to search for conflicts among the various functions. Remember to take sufficient pictures to document your case well. And then click the link in the caption below to complete the questions on TED-Ed.